Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Intangible Knowledge Transmission. Our panelists this morning, Carolina Guerrero-Reyes, Laura Felicitas-Chabelle, Kelly Morrison, and Javier Pereira. This topic this morning is near and dear to my heart. I am the Intangible Cultural Heritage Focal Point for the Brothers Museum and Historical Society, and we are very much engaged and interested in the transmission of intangible cultural heritage and its safeguarding. I don't want to tie everyone up by focusing on me, however, so at this time, I'd like to invite Carolina to take the podium. I don't know, would you ladies like to come up front and sit? Or are you okay to stay there? Everybody said no. Okay, well, do join us.
Good morning, everyone.
Hi.
Okay, so, well, thank you for having me. My name is Carolina, and I'm coming from Universidad Pedagógica Nacional from Colombia. And this is a little bit strange because I'm from the physical education faculty. And this is a project that we have been working on during the last 2 years. And this is what we have so far. So here, I'm going to start. Well, our presentation is called Cultural Memories and Constructions of the Historical Sense amongst current practitioners of the ancient Mesoamerican rubber ball game. So when we talk about historical significance, according to what we have done so far, we talk about game safeguarding and motivations and constructions. So, as I was saying, this is from what we have built, content, and intergenerational transmission of ancestral knowledge. Also, well, that is related to historiographic, archaeological, museographic, and approaches, according to what we have done in our research. First of all, well, the relevance of this, like the long practice of the rubber ball is taking place in North America, which starts in the south of the and then it goes down south to Panama. This is a community practice that we have increasing around South American Caribbean. And of course, now it's reaching to Colombia thanks to some other people that have been studying that. Okay. And the whole part that we have here is how we have the heritage transmission through academic papers and conferences. What we have is we couldn't find transformations related to multicultural and interculturality issues regarding the practice. Okay, so this is the first part. And now, here what we have is the game modalities of the rubber ball game. As I told you, this is part of physical education and is how we can transmit the information to our students or anyone who wants to practice that. So here we have three modalities. Here, that is called Ulama, Boktabok, Shahai, or Tahan. Sorry, that's Namen, Pit. And also we have the forearm, Shahai, and the staff. That is a big staff made of wood and also the ball. According to the practice, each ball has a different weight. So, for example, if you are going to play with your hand, the ball can weigh between 3 to 5 kilograms. Then the forearm is 3 kilograms. And the staff is another kind of rubber ball mixed with some other materials that we need one kilogram. And those are the practices that we have transmitted nowadays with our students or anyone who wants to practice it. Okay. Also, according to the history, we have the way that the rollerball, because here was the iconic icon, let's say, is the rollerball. And it is made of the human rollerball. We have two species, the Brasiliensis and Castilla elastica, and also can be moved, inflamed, or killed through artisanal processes with the natural coagulation of latex. They're totally mixing processes with other materials, make elastic properties of the primordial preservation. So let me show you.
This is one that we made in Colombia, well, with the whole natural process and all in traditional directions from Yes.
And also, if you want to try to,
so that is one of the rubber balls that is we've made it like 3 years ago, and it's made of rubber. Now we're just, according to some the way that the latex is processed, and also it's mixed with some flowers or some plants. Well, they have reserved issues about it, but it's the way that prepared in some traditional way. Okay. And the beginning of the game is, well, they have two teams, and this is the court. Okay, so here we have one example that is located in the leaf, and also we have the medieval ring in Chichen Itza. So that is when two teams try to play alternating poses on the ball, and on opposite terrain from the opposite team or retreat. To maintain the whole action of hitting the ball, and this is a little body parts. So as I told you, the hip, the forearms, and also a good stuff. And we have like accounting times. But the main issue here is how people are getting connected with the tradition. Okay, and well, they have different names for the ball game course. For example, putting by like Tachikon or Tachikon, or in the Navajo language, Opoyam in Yucatec Maya, or John in Kachikel Maya. Okay, so these are different ways to introduce to the rollerball game. And well, here they have different ways to play the game, and this is what everybody has been doing. For us, because now all the contemporary practices are at the end of the 20th century. Most of the initiatives are held in Guatemala and Mexico. Then new countries were in American countries until its current expansion beyond the regions, because most of the regions are located in Central America. So, for example, we have the Central American High University Council that established exhibitions and sport the students' events. Then, the university expanded even during COVID-19 with large workshops, virtual tournaments, and other people participating in training children and women groups. By the last year, then we have the expansion of the modality, which is the biggest one for everyone. The covers states in Mexico, Venezuela, Quintana Roo, Mexico, Michoacán, Tabasco, Chihuahua, Yucatán, and Quintana Roo. And for us, practicing as colonialists, Colombians, and right now we are starting the process in Colombia. Also, lots of communities have expansion, and we have the participants, the Mexican population of Guyana Health Modality, and also we have the American Association of Ancestral Sport of Mayan, Boro, Mayan Boro. In 2015. Okay, so that was the meaning of an object of the study and exhibition. So the first part in the discussion that we found, all the chronicles were dormant when they started, when Europeans reached America and they started in the game with a different type of object that actually bounds. So the problem here was how they reported this, and it seemed like the adaptations of the game were from Europe, not actually emanating from the Americans. So then this is like the opening as well. As you know, the rubber trees closed in America, so they were able to extract the materials to make what we have now, like the games for borrowers, standing for football, volleyball, basket, etc. Okay, and the material which was known for physical elasticity, the solid ball, and well, they were just adapted to. Okay, so then in the 16th century, the game was prohibited because it was against the process of evangelization. But then, during the 7th century and the course of the 18th century, chronicles of religious reported game in northern Mexico, which were later observed by other travelers around the 19th century. Now, by these days, after by the end of the 20th century, the continuity of the practices in Mesoamerica was essential for the current times. And then, by 1968, on the limits, a lot of exhibitions performing this practice of the rule, also in they made a film that is called the Lion of the Game, and just showing the creation of this in 1986. Okay, so then by the 90s, a lot of interesting exhibitions being at universities and museums, exhibitions in Mexico, Vienna, and Lausanne, for instance, and also we have the tourist issues that we can see, for example, the expedition work and the scene artistics are performed. Well, this is like the relationship between tourism and tourism industry and history, how they can get related. And there are other approaches that we have been working and how some other people are and others ways to present and continue playing with the books. For example, right now in this research we're doing, we work with a guy from Guatemala that he implemented the game into the public schools. So this is like a huge attempt to introduce the game and to introduce not only the game but the game through the culture through the game. And okay, thank you. Yes. And then we have, so here the questions are the exhibitions and how we are spreading the practice. This is actually a picture we took at the university. We start something that we call use the diversity ancestral, use the diversities into the world of the game. And then we can adapt it to university life. So how can we show to students and connect? Because, well, some people think that Colombia and Central America are really far away from culture, but we have really strong connections. So how we can contribute to the transformation and safeguard and expansion, and also a sense of identity in the people. And so here, the most important part is Halloween becomes a ritual space to understand traditions and to create new friendship, because this is what's happening in the university. So what we found is how through the game and knowing the whole history and created the whole process through a ritual and then practice the game, including a new sense of identity in the students. So let me show you a video. Help me too. Yes, and with that we finish.
Bueno, actualmente pues, siempre que vamos aquí, los juegos de pelota siempre en toda la Mesoamérica. Cuando hablamos de Mesoamérica, nos referimos a México, Guatemala, Belice, El Salvador, Honduras y una cierta parte de Nicaragua. Los juegos de pelota, pues, requiere de una importancia cultural demasiado grande, ¿verdad? Simplemente totalmente cosmológico, lleva mucha parte del tema espiritual. Y bueno, el nombre como tal, pues hay muchos nombres actuales, ¿verdad? En México le llaman Lama, Pocatoc, en Guatemala hay tres nombres, está Chachay, está el y está el Cha. Actualmente, pues, siempre que nuevos equipos, bueno, nuevos países, a través de sus investigaciones, a través de los pueblos, sobre todo, y buscando el idioma como tal, ellos van creando nuevos nombres, ¿verdad? A través de la pelota y también a través de otras investigaciones que hacen, ¿verdad? Nos basamos a través del idioma. Es como decir, el salón, juego, pitch, pelota. Entonces, como decía, allá manejamos esos términos actuales, ¿no? A través del idioma. Pero realmente sirve de muchos nombres como tal, ¿verdad? Una parte, ¿verdad?, que nos habla en Popol Vuh, que es el libro perifuncional del pueblo Michene, en el relato, ¿verdad?, nos menciona un nombre como tal, como Cha. Como dice Cha, puede ser moralidad en pedazo. Cha, puede ser moralidad de cadera, Cha, puede ser moralidad de bastones, ¿verdad? Entonces, es cuando nosotros realmente conocemos el juego de pelota, ¿verdad? Cuando nosotros representa, ahí sí que es de mucha importancia, porque es un deporte, ¿verdad?, que lo jugaron nuestros ancestros, ¿verdad? Y para venerarlo, obviamente, antes de llegar a juego, se hacen ceremonias. Los equipos tienen sus vidas espirituales. Antes de llegar a una competición, ellos espiritualmente se preparan. Este guía espiritual de los cumpleaños los prepara a través de ceremonias. Ya después de eso, pues, se llega al evento, pero siempre con el guía. El guía espiritual llevando a Saturno, con ciencias, para que ellos estén ahí en toda armonía. Y que la selección, que también para eso sirve también la parte espiritual, ¿verdad? Y ahí en Guatemala, pues, hay muchos equipos que realmente, bueno, yo creo que la mayor parte de los equipos de Guatemala tienen y le guardan mucho respeto a juego de pelota, porque como te digo, la parte espiritual está ahí a través del juego, y es como ellos se conectan, ¿verdad? Bueno, la invitación es cordial, ¿verdad?, para que se unan a este movimiento, ¿verdad?, que el juego de pelota, más que un deporte, ¿verdad?, es algo que nos une como pueblos, como tal, un deporte de mujeres de calidad que surgieron en toda Mesoamérica y que ahora actualmente está en Colombia, pues es bastante interesante, ¿verdad? Los jóvenes lo han tomado así que con mucho entusiasmo y se ve y se siente esa manera, ¿verdad?, de verlos, de ver y jugarlos y están bien contentos, ¿verdad? Entonces la invitación es para algo, ¿verdad? Que si les gustó el juego, pues que lo sigan practicando, porque se vienen eventos importantes donde podemos invitarlos y llevarlos a otros países, ¿verdad? Para que ahí sí que armonicen también con los otros países.
Thanks very much, Carolina. I think we are running a little bit behind time, but I think what I would like to do is to let Carolina answer one or two questions while we queue up Laura's presentation. So does anyone have any questions for Carolina? While we go ahead, sir.
Hi, I hope you can hear me okay.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
That's what I was thinking. Thank you. So I hope you can all hear me okay. First of all, thank you. That was super interesting. I have one minor factual question and then a little more broad question. So I noticed that you said in the presentation that they thought the game was a barrier to evangelization. I wonder why that would be. Was it because of human spirit or something along those lines?
That happens in all over Latin America. They say that Europeans were planning to come with Jesus. And other practicals that were taking time of that was bad sin, okay? So, and it happens also from Colombia. Let me give you another example. Mexican culture in Colombia, they have a lot of places with long, big rocks, and they were like worship their own gods. And for that process, Europeans used to call them the devil. So nowadays, you go to those rocks or spiritual places, and this is la piedra del diablo, the devil's rocks. So, and that is why they start doing that. Yeah, so, and every single little practice that were different from taking the God's word or not allowed or that was prohibited. Is it like?
And my slightly more open question relating to the game and how it's played and so on. From what you were talking, it seems to be getting more and more popular. Do you think it's going to get popular across the whole of, let's say, the Latin American zone or only like Mesoamerica?
The Caribbean, actually, they were like international tournament. Right now, so they were just team getting together to play, and they were like the open championship. And right now, people are getting together to start doing some research about ball games in different countries. For example, they were trying to rescue one from Dominican Republic, and that we are going to try to get into for the next year is into the south of Colombia in the Amazon, because they have a rolling ball game, but nobody plays there because it was the huge history about the rubber there. Well, that is another part of the
story. Yeah. Good. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Just coming to the mic so that other people can hear my question. Are there any plans to either do a joint nomination or for you guys to work on some sort of a nomination for intangible cultural heritage?
Yes, actually they have been working on Mexico and Guatemala are doing that. And I don't know exactly what the moment of the process, but they are working on it.
One last question before you go. What has been the impact on Indigenous practice of this game of international sports with similarities like soccer?
Well, let's say that happens more like exhibitions. For instance, whenever they go play is to show another part of the games in Latin America. And also to learn a little bit the process of how the materials are constituted, the new games like soccer, because this is an adaptation.
No, I understand that. What I'm asking is if, for example, people are playing soccer rather than this game.
Does the
popularity of soccer in America impact?
No, that might. Soccer is still like one of the main games in Latin America. It's not now like we're playing, but of course more people are playing right now. But yes.
Very awesome. Hi, thank you very much for a very interesting presentation. I think my question has more to do with the past, to ask you to unpack a little bit of what you were saying about what the European observers were understanding or were they misinterpreting. I'm not quite sure of how you address that. It seemed like a pretty accurate depiction in that, yeah, as you're saying, not really.
The picture is accurate, but the narrative is different. Yeah, so they say like, they play like we play in Europe. So it seemed like the game was adapted from European practices rather than the practice itself in America.
Okay, so they assumed that it was coming from
yes.
European base.
Yeah, so they are similar studies, of course, from doing research that is not like that.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Good morning. I'm sorry I came late because I came from another session, but I am from Guatemala and I am very interested about your lecture. And I would just like to contribute with something. I think we have the ball game, you know, the Mayan ball game, which was also called the game of death,
mm-hmm.
because the winners would be supposed to were sacrificed, not the losers. No, it was like a privilege to be sacrificed. So it was not a punishment as people think. So I think, as you said, you know, we have been trying to organize leagues of players, but I think the main problem or the main issue, I should say, is that the original game was spiritual. It's not conceived as a sport, a soccer, mm-hmm. or anything. So it wouldn't be, unless you change the concept of the ball game, you can adapt it to modern life.
Mm-hmm.
But in the essence of this game was very spiritual. So that is the challenge. You know, how
yeah.
do you translate this concept into contemporary life? So, but I congratulate you for your lecture. And like I said, we're trying to create these links, even video games. There's a person who has an incredible video game about
yeah.
the ball game.
Uh-huh.
And for kids, it's important to learn, you know, especially for indigenous communities, to learn about their heritage, the richness of the heritage. But again, the challenge will be how to adapt, you know, this concept from spiritual to a sport, you know, to a hobby.
Exactly. No, but actually, thank you so much for what you're saying. And this is kind of the debate right now, because a lot of people that are practicing the rubber rolling are physical educator teachers. So now
The question is that why we have to think, I mean, or establish the relation between the spiritual game and another like kind of a sport game. So I don't know exactly, but this is like the question around right now the game. Well, and the same thing with physical education.
Thank you.
I think we are just about okay. Well, one last question.
The benefit that you have is the concept of sport as culture. So sport is part of the culture in most governments. So the idea of at least indigenous groups and Latin American countries is the adoption of sport as culture. But this is where the tradition kicks in. It goes not as a commodification. It's not sport as a commodity like soccer. But it's the, how do we embed these cultural practices, which include sports, into this intergenerational transmission? But yeah, indeed, that's the benefit that you have in the education system from Latin America, that is not this commodification of knowledge and the transition of, or that's the translation and sharing knowledge from cultural spaces.
No, that is very true. Thank you.
Thank you.